the airport as an end to itself. Planned airport, basically, when we talk about planned airport, for example, we talk about Clark. How are we going to develop Clark? We talk about what? An aerotropolis in Clark, a logistics hub in Clark. We talk about green city in Clark. But how exactly are we going to develop Clark from the point of view of the projected 75 million passengers by 2050? Where's that 70 million passengers going to land? Maia, Clark, Bulacan, what else are the options? Sangli, Laguna de Bay, but there's a lot of options. In Cavite, there's several options. But the point is, when you talk about airports, planned airport cities, because now that the business model of airports is not, it's no longer just putting planes on the ground and off the ground. It's become a business model. Now, just like with rail, there's also a business model. When I took my master's in England, during his time, the business model for airports was basically just getting passengers from the curb to the plane at the shortest possible time. The American model. But if you look at the Schiphol model, the Heathrow model, the business model talks about making money off the tourist before he leaves the country. And you have duty-free, what do you have in Heathrow? Duty-free, hotels, a golf course, what else? A movie, everything. It's a destination point. When we were planning Clark in 1998, we looked at several business models. We looked at the Minneapolis-St. Paul's model, which develops the airport as a destination point, because the Mall of America is the destination point. We basically looked at multi-airport systems. What's the threshold for a multi-airport system for it to be connected? London has three airports, as you know. New York has three airports, and what's the common denominator when we were trying to determine this for ECDA back then? Back then, that was in 1998, the threshold was around 50 million passengers a year before you can consider a multi-airport system. But all of these multi-airport systems, mind you, were all connected to the city. They weren't standalone airports. For Heathrow, Gatwick, and Stansted, they were all connected by rail. Now, Newark is connected. The Americans were, it's also an afterthought as far as America is concerned. Newark is now connected by rail. JFK has a connection to the city. And LaGuardia also has a rail connection to the city as an afterthought. From a transport airport planning perspective, I think we're following the American model. Now, when we talk about Ro-Ro terminals, basically we're talking about two national nautical highways. We're talking about the West and the Central Nautical Highways. And during my time, part of the problem that we thought we pinpointed was that most of the vessels that were plying the route were flat bottom ships, at least 50 years old, and a good 40% of them had wooden hulls. Is that a problem? For example, flat bottom ships, the answer to your question is yes. It's not safe for open seas travel. Now, when it comes to the Ro-Ro ports in Matnog, Allen, Puerto Galera, Calibo, San Ricardo, Surigao, and others, it's a port only. It's not an intermodal port. So when you talk about Ro-Ro from an intermodal perspective, it's connecting the islands, yes. But is it intermodal? Because what are Ro-Ros? Ro-Ros is a means of the transfer of people and goods from roads to basically ships. That's a Ro-Ro. That's the main function of a Ro-Ro. Now, when you talk about connecting them or making sure that they're intermodal, have you been to Port of Matnog? Any of you have been to Port of Matnog? And how is the Port of Matnog? Are there any quarters for people, food? None, right? There's no, it's not even gated. So for, from a security perspective, also, it's also bad, no? Now, sorry about this one. It's supposed for the previous slide. But basically, RORO is not part of the urban transportation network, especially in San Ricardo in Leyte. It's not even part of the national road. You have to go through a dirt road to get to San Ricardo Port. Why? Diba? So they built a port, and then, okay, how do you get there? Nobody's thought about it. Now they're planning to build the port, the road to get to the port. Para everything is an afterthought as far as the, you know, transportation planning is concerned here in the country. No? Now, urban rail. As I said, when we were building MRT3 in 1998, the three lines in the in Metro Manila, LRT1, LRT2, and MRT3, I usually refer to them as three independent republics. Why? Three different signaling systems, three different power supply systems, three different trains. I mean, you know, when Secretary Dominguez, as head of ICC-MEDA, sort of told me, you know, when I was still with the government, Rommel, let's try to make, you know, a common trains. We only have what? We only have 45 kilometers worth of rail. 45. Why do we have to have three sets of different types of trains? For example, LRT1 has three types of trains. LRT1. LRT2 has one, but they're not going to order a new set. MRT3, because of the Chinese trains, now has two. Why do we have to have, for a short length of rail, have to have seven sets of trains? Hong Kong MTR, which has 2,000 trains, has only three types of trains. It's more expensive from the point of view of maintenance, from the point of view of efficiency as well. Now, if the MRT3 train will run on the LRT1 train, the MRT3 trains will be underpowered. If the LRT1 trains will run on the MRT3 line, it's because they're underpowered, their motors will burn up on our system. The signaling system of LRT1 is a axle counter. It means that it counts the number of turns for the train to determine their location on the system. In the case of MRT3, it's a balise system. LRT2, it's radio system. Bakit iba-iba? So what happens is the trains cannot talk to one another. It's not interoperable. So nawawala, because of these inefficiencies, yung rights ng passenger, subsidies for rail. Let me ask you a question. Has anybody thought about the subsidies that we put in building roads? When you build roads, it doesn't matter, right? We buy the right-of-way, we build the road, we build the skyway. Does anybody ask about the subsidy that we have to give to build those roads? But everybody's talking about the subsidy for rail. The right for public transportation, especially for the urban poor, more or less would go towards using mass transportation, which includes rail systems. I'm not a proponent for rail systems. I've worked in the rail system, yes. But you know what? Metro Manila has 78% total population using public transportation. Now, are you going to deprive these people by taking out the subsidies for rail systems and give it more for people who are driving cars and give them, okay, yeah, sure, we'll subsidize the roads, the right-of-way? Why? For me, that baffles my mind. No? We're servicing 78% of the population, making sure that they're connected, and we have and for cars we don't bat anything. No? We don't ask any questions about the subsidies that we use to buy roads. Okay. Now, interconnected. Right now, if you talk about the three systems, are the three lines interconnected? And now I'm going to talk about PNR line. is the three lines, LRT 1, 2, 3, and the PNR lines interconnected? No, then. So from an interconnection point of view, they're not. From an intermodal perspective, transportation, bus. Because buses are supposed to be feeder systems for rail transit systems. Is there an efficient means of transfer, intermodal, from rail to buses or buses to rail? Wala din. No. We talk about the intermodal, the ITS, the integrated transfers, terminal stations. We have one in Coastal Road, we have one in FTI, and we were planning one in the north, somewhere in Balintawa. Question, are these ITS systems interconnected to the rail? It's an afterthought. FTI will build a pedestrian walk to the FTI station of PNR. SWITS, which is the southwest, the one in Coastal, will build a pedestrian walkway from LRT1 station to the SWITS. Afterthought. Intermodal, just so we can call ourselves intermodal. When we talk about intermodal, for example, in Hong Kong Airport, nandun lahat, diba? Bus, rail, taxi, car, and the airport, and the planes. How many of you have noticed, for example, that from the plane in Hong Kong, that you didn't have to take one step from the plane to the curb? Diba? Have you given that a thought, that from the plane, when you're pulling your baggage to the curb, you don't basically take one step down or up. It's flat, it's low, it's basically sloped. Of course it's sloped, no? But the point is, that's how much they have designed your intermodal station to basically make the transfer people from the airport to the curb efficient. Now, toll roads, this is my last slide. Again, right now, the toll systems are independent republics, Metro Pacific and San Miguel. Now we have the Ayala's. What's the line of the Ayala toll road? Daang Hari, no? MCX, right. So, these are independent republics, these different toll payment systems, different lighting systems, different everything. Now, when you talk about toll roads, there's now a prevailing thought that when we talk about toll roads, that we use ODA financing for the civil works and PPP for the O&M, which is the same as with rail. Now, when we talk about both rail, airports, and toll roads, there's three main thoughts as far as concession fees are concerned. And concession fees will impact on the rights of the commuter. First is what is the best? Is it the tariff rate cap? Is it IRR cap? Or is it the highest income to government that should prevail? Now, as far as the British model is concerned, highest rate to the government failed when it comes to telecommunications. As far as IRR cap is concerned, it failed in South America. Tariff rate has worked in Manila Water, in the MWSS model. And so when we talk about PPPs, we talk about the business model, we talk about, of course, what the government will earn, and at the same time, what the government will earn should not impact on the tariff rate of the computer. Because at the end of the day, it's the government who should earn the money. No? At the end of the day, it's the welfare of the user of that asset that we should be thinking about, okay, be it airport, be it port, or be it rail. Now, for now, I think I'd end at that. My time has come up. And I hope that I'll be able to talk to you more about these ideas and these issues during the dialogue later. Thank you very much.